Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming. I wanted to introduce our next speaker, Huma Ahmed Ghosh. Huma Ahmed Ghosh is professor and chair of the Department of Women's Studies at San Diego State University. Ahmed Ghosh has published extensively on women in Afghanistan, Muslim women in India and in the US diaspora, and gendered violence and conflict with a focus on Afghanistan. She has two books titled Contesting Feminisms, Gender and Islam in Asia, and Walking the Tightrope. Asian women's lived realities are in the process of publication by SUNY Press. Currently, she is completing a manuscript titled Women Transforming Communities, Confronting Conflict and Building Peace. Today, she will talk about dilemmas of Islamic and secular feminists and feminisms. Please welcome Huma Ahmed Ghosh. Thank you.
First of all, I want to thank Aisha Momeni for inviting me here. And of course, the 24th International Conference Committee, it's a big honor. I'm especially excited because in my work on gender and Islam, I use a lot of Persian and Iranian feminist work. I think it's the best on Muslim women. So please forgive me if I misrepresent, because I know I'm among Iranian feminists, and if I misrepresent or something. But thank you very much for inviting me to speak here today.
سلام من سهیلا وحدتی هستم و امروز این صحبت رو برای شما به فارسی ترجمه می کنم. پیشا پیش عذر می خواهم اگه ترجمه خیلی دقیق نیست و ترجمه نسبتا آزادی خواهد بود. سپاسگزارم از توجهت.
I will read out most of it and I'll look up to a couple of times, because if I have to say what I have to, I'll be done in 5 minutes, and you know, we need to have a discussion afterwards. So this paper basically is based on my own dilemmas of Islamic feminisms and secular feminisms, and I use it in the plural because there is no one secular feminism, nor is there one Islamic feminism. And so this paper basically, it's multifaceted understanding of Islam, how it can contribute to productive dialogue about the future of Muslim women in both Islamic and secular states. Towards that end, I will discuss the numerous interpretations of Islamic, secular, and collaborative, which I refer to as hybrid feminisms, that have surfaced in Islamic and non-Islamic nations. In this presentation, Muslim women's heterogeneous realities challenge mainstream feminisms, since these women's lives as products of local cultures and politics do not fit into the typical feminist ideological compartments. Muslim women's lives also do not conform to the rigid parameters of a secular or Islamic nation, but are impacted by women's class, region, ethnicity, and local politics. These variables could potentially give women the option to negotiate their status and rights contrary to the dominant ideology. But since 9/11, the current trend towards Islamization of nation states tends towards the shrinking of this space.
بعد اضافه کنم که ایشون اول گفتن که کارشون بیشتر بر اساس کار فمینیست های ایرانی هست که بیشتر از همه در مورد اسلام کار کردن و گفتن که کارشون شاید زیاد دقیق نباشه چون همه چیزها رو نخوندن. ولی این مقاله در مورد درک چند وجهی از اسلام هست که به یک گفتگوی سازنده و چند وجهی درباره آینده زنان مسلمان در کشورهای اسلامی و سکولار می انجامه. در این باره ایشون در مورد توجیهات مختلف اسلامی، سکولار، ائتلافی و ادغامی فمینیسم های گوناگون، چون نمیشه گفت یک فمینیسم، صحبت می کنن که در بین جوامع اسلامی و غیر اسلامی بروز کرده. در این راستا زنان مسلمان با واقعیت های به اصطلاح چالش های گوناگونی روبرو هستند از اون جایی که زندگیشون برآمد فرهنگ محلی سیاست هست و که در عذر میخوام که ترجمه زیاد آسون نیست ترجمه چیز آنی و زندگی زنان مسلمان به اصطلاح اون چارچوب پارامترهایی که این ملت‌های اسلامی یا سکولار دادن به این آسونی نمی‌گنجه و تحت تاثیر طبقه هست، ملیت هست، قومیت هست و مسائل سیاسی محلی که این پارامترها به این زنان به اصطلاح این اختیارات رو میده که توی چارچوب محلی خودشون برای حقوقشون بجنگن و با اون ایدئولوژی مسلط مبارزه کنن که به ویژه بعد از واقعه 11 سپتامبر این جریان این فضا رو تنگ تر کرده در این راستا. Sorry, go ahead. I'll try to be faster next time.
Okay, this is complicated, yeah? In this presentation, I'm advocating collaboration among Islamic and secular feminisms as a way of advancing the understanding of the lived realities of Muslim women in Islamic states and other Muslim communities. There is a pragmatic value to developing a standard for Islamic feminism that can be modern and held up to more oppressive local conditions or politics and the extremes of patriarchy. To do this, one needs a comprehensive review of what local oppressions exist in specific countries and what feminist angles can be brought together in a hybridized version. Do you want to?
Sure. من در این مقاله سعی می‌کنم که در مورد همکاری بین فمینیست‌های اسلامی و سکولار صحبت کنم و اینکه چطوری درک شرایط زندگی زنان مسلمان و دیگران میتونه به این بیانجامه که فمینیسم اسلامی میتونه مدرن باشه و در مقابل پدرسالاری و شیوه‌های سرکوب محلی مقاومت کنه و به زوایای این فمینیسم میپردازم. Slower, please.
Okay. The reality for all women, religious or non-religious, is that they live in patriarchal cultures. Under patriarchy, there are situations where women willingly conform to Islamic norms, even if these norms are seen as oppressive by others, engaging in what I term patriarchy trading, which allows them to claim some agency. It also needs to be recognized that in the discourse on Muslim women's rights, lives and status, there is a contestation of global masculinities and power games. They are played out through control over women's bodies. Recently, this contestation has become very obvious, but it is not a new phenomenon.
واقعیت زندگی زنان مذهبی یا غیر مذهبی اینه که در جوامع مردسالارانه زندگی میکنن. تحت مردسالاری وضعیت زنان جایی که زنان به میل خود به نرم های هنجارهای اسلامی تن میدن، حالا چه اینکه این هنجارها با فشار باشه یا نه، به اون چیزی میانجامه که من بهش میگم معامله مردسالاری، که اجازه میده به اونها که یک برنامه ریزی برای خودشون بکنن، بعضی حقوقشون رو ادعا کنن، که باید همچنین در نظر گرفت که در بحث حقوق زنان مسلمان زندگی و وضعیت اونها تحت تاثیر مردسالاری بین المللی هم قرار میگیره و سیاست های کلی که در جهان در جریانه.
Today, if the topic of Muslim women has become visible and of prime concern, it is not necessarily because of concern over the situation of women in Islamic states and Muslim communities worldwide, but more likely because of specific international and local political agendas. The real apprehension in the West relates to preserving political hegemony, waging of wars, asserting economic control over oil supplies and pipelines, and bringing about cultural and political change.
اگر این مسئله امروز مورد توجه قرار میگیره لزوماً به خاطر توجه به شرایط زنان در کشورهای اسلامی و غیره در سطح جهان نیست بلکه بیشتر به خاطر شرایط ویژه بین‌المللی و سیاسی محلی و ترس واقعی از اینه که غرب میخواد که هژمونی سیاسیش رو حفظ کنه جنگ رو بندازه قدرت سیاسی خودش رو اعمال کنه و نفت رو در دست داشته باشه
Thus, the debate about women's rights becomes complex because it is ridden with not just global and local politics and numerous interpretations of Islam, but also by competing feminisms and masculinities, academic power plays, and colonial and post-colonial analysis. This debate becomes even more complex given the gap between theorizing Islamic feminism for all Muslim women, assuming they're a homogeneous group, and the culture-specific fallouts for Muslim women based on local politics and social norms. Here I will discuss some of the prevailing Islamic and non-Islamic feminisms engaged in by Muslim men and women living both in Islamic states and in non-Islamic states, as they attempt to better understand the complexities of women's lives in the Muslim-dominated regions of Asia.
از این رو بحث حقوق زنان خیلی پیچیده تر میشه چون که نه تنها در سطح سیاست محلی و جهانی جریان داره بلکه توجیهات مختلفی از اسلام وجود داره و همچنین بین به اصطلاح فمینیسم تعبیرات گوناگونی که از فمینیسم و مردانگی وجود داره بحث‌های آکادمیکی که در جریان داره بحث‌های استعماری و پسا استعماری و به ویژه پیچیده‌تر میشه وقتی که ما فاصله بین فمینیسم اسلامی و زنان مسلمان رو در نظر بگیریم حتی اگه فرض کنیم که اونها یک گروه همگون هستن و اتفاقات فرهنگی ویژه‌ای که برای زنان مسلمان با توجه به شرایط سیاسی خودشون و هنجارهای فرهنگیشون اتفاق میفته. در این مقاله من سعی میکنم که بعضی از فمینیسم‌های اسلامی و غیر اسلامی رو که درگیر این بحث شدن مورد توجه قرار بدم توسط زنان و مردان مسلمانی که در هر دو جوامع اسلامی و غیر اسلامی زندگی میکنن که بتونیم یکم از این پیچیدگی‌ها رو در نظر بگیریم.
The two generalized overarching theories at crossroads in Muslim society seem to be Islamic feminism and modern secular feminism. Islamic feminism tends to be viewed as a paradox, while those who conflate it with Western feminism see secular feminism as problematic in Islamic states. Western feminism is viewed as an imposition of Western cultural values in contradistinction to Islamic cultural values. A third trend that seems to be emerging is that of collaborators, which I would like to refer here as hybrid feminism. Hybrid feminism could be the analytical tool to address women's issues as affecting them regionally and culturally. This flexibility is defined through women's real lives in their communities as dictated by their social norms and local and national politics. Such grounded reality of women's lived experiences varies not just from region to region, but also rural through urban, class, tribal, and ethnic identities.
دو تا بحثی که در جوامع مسلمان مطرح میشه فمینیسم اسلامی و فمینیسم سکولار مورد توجه در اینجا فمینیسم اسلامی به عنوان پارادوکس تلقی میشه در مقابل فمینیسم غربی یا فمینیسم سکولار که یک کمی به نظر میرسه در جوامع اسلامی با دشواری مواجه است فمینیسم غربی گویا داره تحمیل میشه توسط فرهنگ غربی به جوامع اسلامی یک راه سومی هست بین فمینیسم اسلامی و فمینیسم غربی یه شیوه ائتلافی که من بهش میگم ایشون بهش میگن هایبرید فمینیسم که شاید به فارسی بتونیم ترجمه کنیم فمینیسم ادغامی که میتونه یک وسیله باشه برای بررسی مسائل زنان که اونها رو به طور منطقی و فرهنگی تحت تاثیر قرار میده و این به ما این اجازه رو میده که بتونیم زندگی زنان رو همونطوری که هنجارهای اجتماعی و سیاستهای ملیشون مورد تاثیر قرار میده بررسی کنیم و علاوه بر اون طبقه ویژگی‌های فرهنگی و هویت قومی اونها رو هم در نظر بگیریم.
To mention just a few forms of feminisms, there are, at the point I'm trying to make is usually there is Western feminism versus Islamic feminism, and they are antagonistic. What I'm trying to say doesn't have to be like that, because there is no one Western or Islamic feminism, and women's lives are dictated by a lot of other factors besides religion, like their class, their ethnicity, the region, etc. But I also want to make a point here that also, and that is why I use the word feminisms, and there are different forms of feminisms. And some of them are, for example, there are Western educated Muslim feminists living outside their home countries who, immersed in and trained by feminisms of their adopted country, base their feminism on human rights discourse and secularism. And some of those authors or researchers or scholars are Moghadam, Moghisi, Shahidian, Jalal, Jahangir, and many others in India and Pakistan. In the same league of foreign educated feminists, especially after 9/11, there is a group of feminists who espouse Islamic feminism as a strategy, and I want to focus on the word strategy, with an emphasis on reinterpretation of the Quran by questioning the Hadith and the Sharia in Islamic states. Most of these feminists have come from secular left intellectual backgrounds like Tohidi, Najmabadi, etc.
دو جور فمینیسم هست، به زبان ساده یکی فمینیسم سکولار، یکی فمینیسم اسلامی، و من میخوام بگم که اینها لزوما رو در روی هم قرار نمیگیرن و میخوام راه سومی ارائه بدم. بیشتر فمینیست هایی که در کشورهای غربی تحصیل کردن اون نگرش فمینیستی کشور میزبان خودشون رو پذیرفتن که بعضی از اینها مانند مقدم، مقیسی، شهیدیان، جلال، جهانگیر هستن و برخی از اونها به فمینیسم اسلامی رو آوردن و شرع اسلام رو مورد بحث قرار میدن و از اون طریق میخوان حقوق زنان رو به دست بیارن. از این دست میشه توحیدی و نجم آبادی رو نام برد.
There is scholarship that propounds an Islamic feminism based on a proper interpretation of the Quran, where these scholars feel that the Quran does guarantee equal rights to women. And these authors and scholars are Wadud, Webb, Hassan, and there are many others, Mir Hosseini, Marnisi, Karmi. Other perspectives are also grounded in people's class backgrounds, the rural-urban divide, and ethnicities, by feminists from Turkey, India, and Pakistan, to mention a few countries, who try to bring in issues of local cultures, class, and theories of patriarchy to explain women's low status in society as more important than Islam.
Should we let it be? Have we talked about it? بعضی از فمینیست ها در مورد تعبیر مناسب از اسلام صحبت می کنند و مانند میر حسینی، و بعضی از فمینیست ها هستند مانند برخی فمینیست های ترکیه، هندوستان، پاکستان که در مورد فرهنگ مردسالاری مشخص اون جامعه صحبت می کنند.
So now I want to talk briefly about Islamic feminisms. Numerous kinds of Islamic feminists can be identified. All these theorists are seeking Muslim women's emancipation within the rubrics of Islamic patriarchy, whether progressive, modernist, traditionalist, neo-Islamist, or fundamentalist.
Sorry, sometimes it gets difficult. گونه‌های مختلف فمینیسم اسلامی رو میشه برشمرد که همه اونها یه جور آزادسازی زنان مسلمان رو در نظر دارن و با مردسالاری اسلامی به شیوه مدرن و مترقی میخوان روبرو بشن.
I want to quote the work of Rebecca Foley. She works on Malaysia. And in this paper, I talk about Malaysia and Iran because they both have similar issues but also bring out the differences I'm trying to talk about with feminisms. And she talks about, in Malaysia, she talks about two main streams of Islamic feminisms falling into a discourse on equity and equality. Foley elaborates that equity refers to fairness, whereas equality to equal rights with men.
من اینجا میخوام در مورد کار ربکا فولی صحبت کنم از مالزیا که یک وجوه که در مورد دو جریان فمینیسم اسلامی که مالزی و ایران کارهای فمینیستی تو مالزی و ایران وجوه مشترکی دارن و دو تا بحث رو در نظر میگیرن ایکویتی و ایکوالیتی یعنی عدالت و برابری.
Attempts are made by Islamic and non-Islamic equity feminist scholars to discuss the progressiveness of the Quran, given the social situation in Arabia around the 7th century. They cite this period of progressiveness to highlight the issues of gender equity prescribed in the Quran. A common quote from the Quran on the issue of gender equality in marriage reads, "And of his signs is this, that he created mates for you, for yourselves, that you might find tranquility in them, and he put between you love and compassion."
بیشتر تلاشایی که میشه در مورد اینکه بگن اسلام دین برابریه اینه که توجیه میکنن که در قرن هفتم میلادی در عربستان زمانی که اسلام به وجود اومده و به ویژه از این حدیث رو از آیه رو از قرآن نقل قول میکنن که ما برای شما خدمتکارانی آفریدیم که در یعنی زن و برای مردان زنان رو آفریدیم که در آنها آرامش بیابید و بین شما و آنها عشق و علاقه قرار دادیم.
According to these scholars, it is the biased interpretations of the Quran and conflation with local cultures that have led to abysmal conditions for women in Muslim states. Numerous women theologians and other Muslim scholars list instances of liberated women in the Quran. These include Khadija, the Prophet's first wife who owned a business, and Aisha, the Prophet's last wife who led her battalion to war on a camel. There were also instances of women's improved status, such as forbidding female infanticide, endorsements by Islamic scholars that women are protected and loved, and that the Quran does not advocate veiling or segregation of the sexes.
In academic ha, barchi academic ha migan ke in tabirat az قرآن بر اساس اون فرهنگ محلی عربستان باعث یک سری تبعیض‌های علیه زنان شده ولی اونهایی که ازش دفاع میکنن میگن که متن قرآن یه سری مشخصهای آزادسازی برای زنها داره از خدیجه میگن که خودش بزینس داشته زن بازرگانی بودی از عایشه میگن که مثلا سوار شتر شده و جنگی رو رهبری کرده رو انداخته و مثالهای دیگه میارن مثلا اینکه زنده به گور کردن دختران قدغن شده توسط اسلام و اینکه گفته شده که زنها رو باید بهشون عشق ورزید و لزوماً حجاب زنان در قرآن نیومده.
Ironically, this understanding belies the reality of most women's lives as religious rights, right claims, ironically, this understanding belies the reality of most women's lives as the religious right gains prominence in most Muslim states. What emerges from such discussions of the virtue of the Quran and women's rights is the disconnect in the discourse on women's status in Islam with the reality of women, Muslim women's lives. Such a discourse, though based on a study of Islamic jurisprudence, does not effectively challenge the patriarchal and masculinist interpretation of Islamic texts, nor accommodate for women's status as it is played out in reality.
متاسفانه چنین تعبیرهایی از قرآن با زندگی زنان در جامعه جوامع مسلمان امروز نمیخونه و حقوق اونها رو در نظر نمیگیره و واقعیت زندگی زنان رو در نظر نمیگیره و برای زنان در مبارزه با مردسالاری پیامدی نداره.
First, the Quran, while appealing to all Muslims, men and women, to a common faith where they will be treated with love and compassion, also has verses that privilege men over women as their protectors and providers. What is ignored widely by Islamic jurists who are trying to prove gender equality in the Quran are verses such as, and I'm quoting here, men have authority over women because Allah has made them superior to the others and because they spend of their wealth to maintain them. Good women are obedient. They guard their unseen parts because Allah has guarded them. As for those from whom you fear disobedience, admonish them and send them to beds apart and beat them. Then if they obey you, take no further action against them. In this complementarity of genders, the dominance of men over women is reflected in verses where men have the right to reprimand their wives physically too if she does not comply.
قرآن گرچه برای همه مسلمان ها اومده زن و مرد ولی کن و میگه که زنها رو زنهاتون رو دوست بدارید ولی آیه هایی داره که به مردها میگه که اولا مردها رو نانآور و سرپرست زنان میدونه و میگه که شما اختیاردار زنانتون هستین و خدا شما رو سرور اونها قرار داده و شمایید که برای اونها زندگی رو فراهم میکنید و اگه به حرف شما نکردن حق دارید دعواشون کنید باشون نخوابید کتکشون بزنید و هر وقت به حرفتون کردن اون وقت میتونید مثل سابق باشون رفتار کنید و به اصطلاح با اینکه گفته میشه که هر دو تا یه جور عدالت برای هر دو تا جنس زن و مرد در نظر گرفته میشه ولی مردها رو بالاتر و فراتر از زنها قرار داده.
In quotes, it takes two women's testimony versus one man's. Divorce is unilateral, prohibiting women from appealing for divorce, etc. More important, the need to take recourse to the Quran to establish contemporary social norms of inequality may be an unfair reference to the text itself, which was revealed 14 centuries ago. If, as these authors suggest, the Quran is indeed a progressive text, then the text should be interpreted to keep up with changing times and discourses based on human rights and citizenship. On the issue of Khadija and Aisha being progressive role models for Muslim women, in this group, I should not be taking the name of Aisha, I know that. There is no doubt that having Muslim role models is better than Western female role models for young women in Muslim societies. But if the state does not institute policies and laws to achieve those heights that it claims the Prophet's wives had achieved, then the rhetoric of role models is irrelevant.
Thank you. در این زمینه ما می‌بینیم که شهادت دو زن برابر یک مرد زنها حق تقاضای طلاق ندارند و با اینکه بنابراین استفاده از قرآن واقعا زن و مرد رو هر دو رو در نظر به اندازه در نظر نمیگیره و اونهایی که میگن متن قرآن یه متن مترقی است شاید برای اون زمان عربستان سعودی متن مترقی بوده ولی اگه واقعا می‌خوایم مترقی نگهش داریم باید بروزش کنیم و تغییرش بدیم متناسب با شرایط زمان و اونهایی که میگن خدیجه و عایشه و ایشون که شاید عایشه مدل مناسبی برای جمعیت نباشه چون ما شیعه هستیم میگن که باید الگوی زنان مسلمان هستند باید در این جوامع قانون‌گذاری و سیاست‌گذاری‌هایی بشه که زنان جوان واقعا بتونن به حقوق خودشون برسن و توامند سازی بشن.
There is also an attempt here to diffuse patriarchy, which is a universal phenomena, with the word of God, especially by Islamic feminist theologians. But again, it is within the confines of the text that somewhat liberal claims are being made about women's status. Islamic feminists, in turn, end up being used by religious extremist states to show the Western world that Islam preaches equality between genders, while for women in these states, the reality continues to be one of oppression, ironically in the name of Islam.
در اینجا ما تلاشی رو هم می‌بینیم که می‌خواد مردسالاری رو که زیر نام خدا یا الله انجام می‌گیره یک کمی کم رنگ کنه مخصوصا توسط این تئوریسین‌های فمینیسم اسلامی که با تعبیر اینکه حقوق زنان در اسلام داده میشه ما می‌بینیم که جناح راست اسلامی از اینها استفاده میکنه برای اینکه بگه که ما برابری داریم بین جنس زن و مرد در حالی که در این کشورها واقعیت به گونه دیگری است و زنها حقوقشون سرکوب میشه.
And now I'll talk briefly about secular feminism. At its base, Islamic feminists use religion as a framework to define gender roles, structure of the family and community, and ultimately its inclusion in the formation of the nation-state in which the individual is subsumed. Secular feminists, on the other hand, base their rationale for women's rights on a human rights discourse to enable and empower the individual in a secular democracy to create a civil society. As Maghadam puts it, although religious reform is salutary and necessary, it is important to recognize its limitations. Women's rights and human rights are best promoted and protected in an environment of secular thought and secular institutions.
فمینیست های اسلامی سعی میکنن که چارچوب جنسیت رو در تعریف خانواده بگنجونن ولی فمینیست های سکولار سعی میکنن که حقوق زن رو بر اساس حقوق بشر تعریف کنن در این زمینه مقدم میگه که اگرچه اصلاحات اسلامی لازم هست ولی مهمه که ما محدودیت هاش رو هم درک کنیم و بدونیم که حقوق زن و حقوق بشر تنها در جامعه سکولار که محقق میشه و توسط نهادهای سکولار
A call for secular democracy in Muslim states as a prerequisite to ensure rights for women or some semblance of human rights for all men and women is based on various reasons, most of them in contestation to an Islamic state. For example, when a state is declared Islamic, which interpretation of Islam would empower the state? The recent situation in Iraq has educated the West about Shias and Sunnis. This divide is only one of the many that contribute to the multivariant interpretation of the Quran. This could lead to another issue, whose interpretation at what historical political juncture? Another concern is, what would the status of non-Muslims and Muslims of different shades be in an Islamic state? Examples of ill treatments of Shias by Sunnis, Sunnis by Shias in Iraq, Christians in Pakistan, Hindus in Malaysia and Bangladesh, and Sikhs in Afghanistan are a few examples that bring to the forefront the fears of a theocratic state. From a secularist perspective, specifically for women, Islamic states control family laws to perpetuate the perfect family as prescribed by religion along gendered lines. A combination of strict family laws and religiously prescribed modesty would inhibit women's mobility and freedom, etc.
یک نکته مهمی رو که باید در نظر بگیریم در جواب اسلامی اینه که بر اساس کدوم اسلام، کدوم تعبیر از اسلام هست که ما حقوق زنان رو در نظر میگیریم. وضعیت اخیر در عراق به ما نشون میده در مورد شیعه و سنی همین مسئله رو که یکی از موارد اختلافی است که ما می‌بینیم در مورد تعبیر از قرآن که میتونه به مسائل دیگه هم بیانجامه مثلا اینکه کدوم تعبیر تاریخی سیاسی رو ما داریم از اسلام و مسئله دیگه این که وضعیت غیر مسلمون ها یا مسلمون های دیگه چی میشه مثلا در پاکستان وضعیت مسیحی ها چی میشه در عراق وقتی جایی که شیعه ها کنترل دارن وضعیت سنی ها چی میشه این سنی ها کنترل به دست دارن وضعیت شیعه ها چی میشه به همین ترتیب وضعیت هندوها و مالزی و بنگلادش و غیره
Sorry, I didn't
translate the last part about the family?
That's okay. We're moving fast.
Okay.
Forward.
Sorry.
So, but also, secularism does not have one meaning in its various avatars. It is seen as a Western imposition that belittles and marginalizes not just religions, but local cultures and moral values. And the best example for that is Turkey and France. Both claim to be secular. In Turkey, because of secularism, the Muslims were not allowed to wear headscarves. Now they do, but for the longest time they did not. And in France, their interpretation of secularism is that there should be no religious symbol publicly displayed, and so there was a banning of headscarves. And with Turkey today, because of secularism, they claim on the basis of human rights that women should be allowed to wear headscarves. So, yeah.
Okay. ما همین مسئله رو در مورد حکومت‌های سکولار داریم و تعبیرهای مختلفی که اونها دارن. مثلا در مورد ترکیه و فرانسه مسئله حجاب زنان اخیراً در ترکیه این حق رو دارن که تو این کشور سکولار با حجاب به دانشگاه اینا برن، قبلا این حق رو نداشتن، در حالی که در فرانسه هنوز این مسئله است و زنها در مکان‌های عمومی حجاب اسلامی نمیتونن داشته باشن.
So basically what I have done so far is complicate Islamic feminism and secular feminism, because I'm trying to suggest that there may be some meeting of halfway or collaboration, which I refer to as hybrid feminism, because while a secular democracy would be a desired state of affairs, concessions are made to fight for women's rights based on certain issues that do not necessarily challenge the dominant system at that historical point. Hale Afshar sums up the situation in Iran. Islamist women have located their negotiations with the government within the context of Islam and its reconstructed meanings, while secular women have chosen to present their protest in terms of human rights and the international recognition of women and the universal entitlements. Afshar continues, what both groups seek is the uplifting of constraints placed on women's social and political integration by the post-revolutionary government.
من تو اینجا سعی کردم بگم که هم در مورد اسلام و هم در مورد فمینیسم اسلامی و فمینیسم سکولار یه سری پیچیدگی هست و من میخوام اینجا فمینیسم ادغامی رو معرفی کنم که شاید بشه ترکیبی از هر دو باشه و شرایط محلی رو هم در نظر بگیره در بررسی وضعیت حقوق زنان. حاله افشار این رو به این شکل خلاصه میکنه که زنان در مورد ایران، در مورد وضعیت زنان در ایران، که زنان مسلمان در چارچوب اسلام با حکومت مذاکره میکنن و سعی میکنن حقوقشون رو به دست بیارن، در حالی که زنان سکولار بر مبنای حقوق بشر و استانداردهای بین المللی سعی میکنن این حقوق رو به دست بیارن، و در حالی که هر دو تا گروه سعی میکنن برای حقوقشون بجنگن. چیزی که هر دو تا گروه سعی می‌کنن براشون بجنگن در حکومت پس از انقلاب حقوقشونه.
Consequently, Islamic feminism and secular feminism have to be understood in their historical context. I will sort of move faster than this here.
در نتیجه فمینیسم اسلامی و فمینیسم سکولار هر دو باید تو چارچوب تاریخیشون بررسی بشن.
In secular states with substantial Muslim populations, strategizing for Muslim women's rights has to be done differently. This is primarily because all women in such states need to unite to challenge the patriarchy to grant women their rights within the civil society. For Iran, Pove points out, many, and in quotes, many secular feminists see the struggle for more reforms to empower women as very important, and in this they welcome their unity with Muslim feminists. But they also question the whole notion of Muslim feminism and are raising very important questions: to what extent can they rely on the support of Muslim feminists? While this question is itself problematic, it is posed by Pove in the context of Iran, where there is a coming together of all feminist forces to bring about changes in family laws to benefit Iranian women.
در جوامعی که اکثریت مردمش مسلمان هستند، استراتژی برای به دست آوردن حقوق زنان مسلمان باید به شیوه متفاوتی انجام بشه به ویژه برای اینکه همه زنان در چنین شرایطی باید با هم متحد بشن که حقوقشون رو به دست بیارن در مورد ایران پووی میگه که بسیاری از فمینیست های سکولار مبارزه برای اصلاحات رو برای توانمندسازی زنان خیلی مهم میدونن و از اتحاد و همکاری با زنان با فمینیست های مسلمان استقبال میکنن اما در این حال از خودشون سوال میکنن که این فمینیست های مسلمان تا کی میتونن همراه ما باشن و با هم همکاری بکنیم این مسئله با اینکه خودش مسئله سازه و پووی در اینجا در مورد ایران مطرح میکنه ولی کن مسئله ایه که این مسئله اتحاد همه فمینیست ها
That's okay. And, I can just continue.
Sorry. And, sorry. Just a bit in minimum kasmati baadi.
You know, I'll continue to come back.
Okay, sure.
This strategy, that is of combining the two, is welcome and astute way of claiming at least those rights that are guaranteed in the Quran. So the point I'm trying to make here is if it's a fundamentalist state, then it is a strategy that feminists are using to look into the Quran to find the rights that women do have, and then talk, even though they're secular, to talk to Islamic feminists to improve the situation of women. But in secular states, the Muslim community needs to work with everybody to demand rights based on human rights. So let's move on.
Okay.
Yeah. I think the best conclusion was, I'm quoting from Denise Candiotti's work. She says that current feminist literature goes as far as claiming that if secularization of the political sphere and extensive democratization of society does not occur in the Middle East, women's status will not change. On the other hand, some feminist theologians attempt to establish Islam's compatibility with emancipation of women. It is somewhere between these two polarized views that the reality of Muslim women's life plays itself out. Through conforming to an Islamic lifestyle, the Muslim woman is simultaneously seen by Westerners as a symbol of their strict interpretations of the Quran and politics to the outside world. If she does not conform, she is seen as betraying the Islamic cause by her brothers and by Westerners as reaffirming their belief in the oppressive institutions of Islam. Such external construction and expectations of her behavior thus render her own decisions, choices, and life circumstances invisible, and her reality is reduced to a simplistic and judgmental interpretation.
کانتیوتی میگه که ادبیات فمینیستی معاصر ادعا میکنه که سکولارسازی فضای سیاسی و دموکراتیزه کردن جامعه در خاورمیانه تا در خاورمیانه انجام نگیره وضعیت زنان تغییر نخواهد کرد از سوی دیگه بعضی از توریسیان های فمینیست میگن که برای اینکه ما اسلام رو همخوان ما میتونیم اسلام رو همخوان بکنیم طوری که در راستای آزادسازی زنان باشه همخوان بکنیم با ارزش های آزادسازی زنان و یه چیز بینابینی بین این دوتا قطب که یکیشون میگه حتما باید سکولار بشه زن آزادسازی بشن یکیشون میگه نه با اسلام هم میشه کنار اومد ما میتونیم یه چیز بینابینی داشته باشیم که واقعیت زندگی زنان هست. زنایی که به هنجارهای اسلامی تن در میدن و با اون شیوه اسلامی کار میکنن و از نظر غربی ها سمبول سرکوب رژیم های اسلامی هستند که هیچ حقوقی ندارن و از نظر مسلمون ها سمبول یک تعبیر قرآنی هستند که به اصطلاح اسلام رو نماد اسلام هستند به دنیای بیرون که اگر همخوانی نکنن با اون به اصطلاح هنجارهای اسلامی یک جورایی خیانت کردن به برادرهاشون برادرهای اسلامی و باید به دنیای غرب نشون بدن با اسلام سازی خودشون که به این چیزها پایبند هستن.
I'm going to conclude now. Change, however, is a process. It's not a solution. For feminists, there is always a dilemma working within or from outside the system. Similarly, for women in Islamic states and in Muslim communities, dilemmas exist as to should they contest internal oppressive religious norms or support their communities in their resistance to westernization. As spelled out in this paper, these dilemmas mainly exist because of the politicization of not just Islam, but also secularism. There needs to be a multi-pronged approach to understanding feminism in Islamic countries and Muslim communities, giving prime importance to the multi-causal ground reality of women's lives. For example, while a policy-oriented effort has to be made to challenge the existing patriarchal order, the complexity of such patriarchy rooted in class, tradition, religion, etc., has to be broken down. A human rights discourse has to be introduced into social systems that empower women to decide their own lives within a framework amenable to them. On the one hand, the contemporary politicization of Islam is a response to the ongoing crisis of the modern so-called secular nation state in the world, and on the other, it is an expression of defensive culture. Also, much of the discussion post 9/11 around women's issues in Islamic and Muslim minority societies is based on the urgency to defend Islam. For Muslim women, this becomes problematic. Should they defend Islam as a monolith faith which provides no space for a critique, or should they judge their lives through their multi-layered identities? Thank you.
همونطور که در این مطلب بیان کردم این بحث ها به این دلیل وجود داره که نه تنها اسلام الان سیاسی شده بلکه سکولاریسم هم سیاسی شده و ما باید یک رویکرد چند جانبه‌ای داشته باشیم به درک فمینیسم در کشورهای اسلامی و جوامع اسلامی و اهمیت درجه یک رو به واقعیت‌های چند جانبه‌ای بدیم که زندگی زنان رو می‌سازه. برای مثال در حالی که ما از نظر سیاسی باید به چالش بکشیم نظم مرد سالاری رو، پیچیدگی این مرد سالاری که ریشه در طبقه سنت و مذهب داره باید در هم بشکنه. یک بحث درست باید معرفی بشه و به وجود بیاد در این جوامع که در راستای توانمندسازی زنان باشه، طوری که اونها بتونن در مورد زندگیشون تصمیم بگیرن که با شرایطشون همخوانی داشته باشه. از سوی دیگه از سیاسی سازی اسلام شاید بشه گفت واکنشی به بحرانیه که به اصطلاح کشورهای سکولار در جهان امروز ساختن. و از سوی دیگر یک فرهنگ تدافعی هست به ویژه در پس از شرایط 11 سپتامبر در مورد مسائل زنان در کشورهای اسلامی و جواب اسلامی یک ضرورتی وجود داره گویا برای دفاع از اسلام و برای زنان مسلمان این مسئله پیش اومده که آیا اونها باید از اسلام دفاع کنن به عنوان مثلا یک دین همگون که هیچ جایی برای انتقاد و به دست آوردن حقوقشون و انتقاد به وضعیت موجود نمیذاره یا اینکه این کار رو نکنن. دوستان عزیز من بازم خیلی عذر میخوام از این ترجمه شکسته که شرمنده. آیا سوالی هست؟
Okay, thank you very much. I have a problem with using this term, Islamic feminism. Feminism means equality for women and men. And Islam doesn't give this such as, I mean, equality to women. So why we have to promote Islamic feminism as a phrase or as a term? Thank you.
I translated quickly. پرسش در مورد واژه فمینیسم اسلامی و اینکه این خانم پرسیدن این واژه متناقضه و چرا شما این اصطلاح رو به کار میبرید و تبلیغ میکنید.
That's a good question, and I'm in agreement with you. But I've been doing research in Afghanistan for many years. I now work on gendered violence and conflict in Afghanistan. And also with my research in Pakistan and amongst Indian Muslims, there is no denying what you're saying, that if feminism, and any other word we may call it by, is about equality, then why use the word Islamic? From my research experiences, I have found that in, and I use it specifically in relation to nation states that are fundamentalist, because in India we use the word Hindu feminism, which also sounds oxymoron to me, is that when women don't have choices, when there is oppression, then I want to say that the feminists in these states, I want to say they strategize. There are two kinds of Islamic feminists, to put it very broadly. One is are those who remain within those countries and strategize some change, saying, okay, the religious texts give these women some rights. Let's fight for those rights. But then there are others who have problems with, Islamic feminists, who say, no, the Quran does give equal rights, and it's the culture that is bad, and the politicians are bad, and it's the hadith and the sharia. But that second set of feminists, I would not use the word feminism, just like you're saying. But for the first set, if it is something that gives women in oppressive cultures a leg to stand on, then it's just a beginning. And hopefully, if they are empowered, say, through education, or they're fighting for rights for employment and mobility, it could go somewhere. But I totally agree with you.
اجازه بده من سریع ترجمه کنم. پرسش خیلی خوبیه. من در افغانستان کار کردم و حالا در مورد خشونت علیه زنان کار میکنم. این چیزیه که ما در جوامع بنیادگرا به کار میبریم و اصولا ما دو جور فمینیست اسلامی در اونجا میبینیم. یکی فمینیست های اسلامی که با استفاده از اسلام میخوان به حقوق خودشون دست پیدا کنن و میگن اسلام اینو میگه، در راستای اون مبارزه میکنن. یه عده مسلمان هایی هستن که اسم خودشون رو فمینیست میذارن و میگن اسلام همینه که از حقوق زنان دفاع میکنه و همین شرع اسلام کافیه و حقوق زن همینه که میگه، و من هم با اینها مخالفم، اینها رو فمینیست نمیدونم. ولی واقعیت اینه که تو جوامع بنیادگرا ما مجبوریم از این اصطلاح استفاده کنیم چون واقعیت زندگی اونجاست.
من میتونم فارسی صحبت کنم؟
من به انگلیسی برایشون ترجمه میکنم.
ولی خواهشم اینه که به همون شکلی که چیزی میکنم ترجمه بکنیم. ممنون میشم ازتون. با تشکر از اینکه مسئله رو که عنوان کردید به عنوان به اصطلاح فمینیسم اسلامی یا فمینیسم سکولار، که دو چیز متفاوت از هم هستن. و سوال اولم اینه که با در نظر گرفتن این که خود اسلام یعنی ریشه مرد سالاری در جوامع اسلامی و غیر اسلامی، بالخصوص در جوامع اسلامی، خود اسلام بر اساس قرآنی که همین الان اشاره کردن، که گفتن در خود قرآن ما داریم آیاتی که میگه زن باید تبعیت کنه از مرد، یعنی در واقع قرآن و اسلامی که زیر سوال باید بره و چالش بشه، نه تقسیم کردن به سکولار یا اینکه به اصطلاح فمینیسم اسلامی. اگه میخواین تا اینجا رو سوال کنید، صحبت
سوالتون چی بود؟
سوالم این بود که ایشون با در نظر گرفتن اینکه عنوان میکنه که فمینیسم سکولار یعنی غیر مذهبی و همچنین فمینیسم مذهبی به عنوان فمینیسم اسلامی، right؟ و ریشه اینها رو من در خود اسلام میبینم، یعنی ما نمیتونیم جدا کنیم بر اساس قرآن که آیه‌اش رو که الانشون اشاره کردن که میگه مرد صاحب به عنوان به اصطلاح مالک زن به نوعی حتی اگر در رابطه مسائل جنسی هم اگر زن به اصطلاح توافقی نداشته باشه به نوعی تجاوز من میدونم این حق رو داره که ایشون نظر سوال من اینه که ریشه این چیزی رو که میفهمی ایشون صحبت میکنن در واقع خود اسلامه که پرورش دهنده به اصطلاح مرد سالاری
Can you ask a question so because I'm not understanding
The question is how
Yes.
شما فرمودین که ریشه شما
He's asking. Yeah, what is the question?
The question is, what do you think about the different kinds of feminism, which they are not Islamic, they are secular, but they are not Islamic. They are left wing, and the base of Islamic fundamental men dominion comes from the religion, comes from Islam. We can't divide them. If we go deeper, we see, okay, woman doesn't have any He's right in Islamic it. Religion, which we are he dividing
says,
them.
He says that patriarchy is rooted in Islam.
Yeah.
ولی من سوال نمیبینم شما فقط من اینه که
نظر ایشون در رابطه با فمینیست های چپ فمینیست های چپ که اصلا مذهب رو قبول ندارن مذهب یه مسئله خصوصیه فمینیست های چپی که در 1980 ایران رو بخوام مثال بزنم تا 88 صدها زن مبارز فمینیست در رابطه با تساوی حقوق زن و مرد کشته شده یعنی رژیم اسلامی کشتشون خب نظر شما در مورد اون نوع فمینیست ها چیه که در سر جهان بسیار زیاد
His question is, you talk about the secular feminists and Muslim feminists. There have been leftist feminists in Iran, and hundreds of them have been executed by the government. What do you say about them?
No, that's a tragedy.
I think his point is...
You're making a point. I don't think he's asking a question. The thing is that Islamic... I don't get exactly what you said, but... I will say that personally I am a secular left person and I think that there is a contradiction with religion and Islam and the in a fundamentalist state it is more difficult to fight for rights than in a secular state because the state is supposed to be non-religious.
So in a-
ببخشید ما 5 دقیقه دیگه وقت داریم اگه میشه خواهش کنم ما سوالا رو بگیریم و بعد خیلی متشکرم مرسی
Thank you, Huma. I enjoyed your overview of the issues and appreciate especially your stressing the commonalities and trying to close the gap and bring about more collaboration and coalition rather than divergence and so forth, which has been also my emphasis. But I feel compelled to make a correction or
Yes,
request that you make a correction. If someone does study of lesbian feminism or gay movement, does that make the scholar that studies them a gay or lesbian?
No.
No. So why then you considered me as an Islamic feminist? I'm not an Islamic feminist.
No, you're not. That's true.
I have, as a as a scholar, as an academic, feminist, activist, I have been analyzing and theorizing different strands of feminism within the real ground of what is happening on the ground, rather than in abstract. And so I have been. I have faced this phenomenon that they call themselves, some of them feminists, Muslim feminists or Islamic feminists, some even don't call themselves feminists. But my analysis, like people like Najm Abadi also, I don't think Najm Abadi is Islamic feminist either. I don't see any difference between my analysis and that of Denis Candioti. Or that of Valentin Mogaddam. We actually share the same analysis and the same strategy, which is emphasizing coalition building and finding common grounds to fight for our rights and improve women's legal rights and change policy of the state. That is the goal, rather than getting trapped into these boxes, mm-hmm. ideological boxes. Because for me, if a Muslim feminist, mm. or even if she doesn't call herself feminist, mm. if she's fighting polygamy, I can find a common ground yeah. with her. That is, my approach is very pragmatic, non-ideological, non-religious. Mm. I'm a religious person myself. I don't belong to mm. any religion. So it's just a bit inaccurate and also unfair to categorize people who are studying these things. So let me translate it myself, if you don't mind. سوال من این بود. من اول تشکر کردم از همکارم. من نایره توحیدی. ببخشید. من تشکر کردم از همکارم هما احمد که سالها میشناسم کارش و خواهش کردم و اینکه ایشون هم مثل من تلاش میکنن که علارغم تفاوت‌های عقیدتی و ایدئولوژیک تلاش زنها رو چه اونهایی که مسلمان هستن دین باور هستن و چه اونهایی که اصلا بیدین هستن از انواع فمینیستا به هم نزدیک کنن و به یک برنامه مشترک عملی برسن. این اپروچ ایشون، منم همین اپروچ دارم. منتها من از ایشون خواهش کردم که یک اصلاح و یک تصحیح در تحلیلشون انجام بده. من سوال کردم آیا اگر کسی روی لزبیان فمینیستا کار میکنه، تحلیل میکنه کارهای اونا رو، یا روی گی موومنت کار میکنه، یا مثلا روی حقوق بچه ها کار میکنه، خودش بچه میشه بچه چون داره حقوق بچه ها کار میکنه، یا خودش لزبیان لزومن، نه، داره روی این مسئله به عنوان یه جامعه شناس، به عنوان یه اکادمی کار میکنه. بنابراین ایشون منو مثلا کاتگورایز کردن، یا همکارم خانم نجم آبادی رو، به عنوان اسلامیک فمینیست، در که من یه آدم کاملا لایک و بدون دین هستم، به هیچ دینی تعلق ندارم. من به عنوان آکادمیک و فمینیست و اکتیویست دارم این نیروهای مختلف، گرایش‌های مختلف رو در جنبش فمینیستی دیدم و سالهاست اینا رو سعی کردم تئوریزه کنم، تحلیل کنم و استراتژی پیشنهاد کنم که چطوری ما علارغم تفاوت‌ها، چه لیبرال باشیم، لیبرال فمینیست باشیم، چه مارکسیست فمینیست باشیم، چه جویش فمینیست باشیم، کریستیان فمینیست باشیم، مسلم فمینیست باشیم. و ضمناً I prefer Muslim feminism rather than Islamic feminism. Because I don't want to essentialize these things. خب من عقیدم همیشه این بوده که به جای اینکه ما بیاییم اینها رو توی باکس جعبه های جداگانه بذاریم، اینا رو بیاریم با هم.
They want us to stop, so can I just clarify?
I'm just translating.
No, because I think there's a misunderstanding, that's why I don't want you to continue. The way I've written it and in the translation.
I apologize for translation.
That's why I'm trying to stop you, because I haven't put you in a category, by the way. What I have said here, I want to just answer her. It'll take me a minute. I want to say that you and Najma Badi, coming from the secular left intellectual backgrounds, are finding strategies to come together. So the very thing you are is what I wrote here, because I know you and your work. So no, I would not see you as an Islamic feminist. And as I explained to the previous questioner, that there are two types. But you are not in my paper categorized.
ببخشید ما فقط یه دقیقه وقت داریم، اگه 30 ثانیه سوالتون رو بگید و 30 ثانیه جواب.
اوکی. من ترجیح میدم به فارسی صحبت بکنم. سوال من این هستش که این خانمای فمینیست اسلامی که یه تضاد بزرگی توش،
why don't you come out and say it, because we look bad trying to stop them mid sentence.
Sorry.
Okay. We can talk outside.
I can say it in English. I want to know the Islamic feminists that, you know, is a huge contradiction in term. How are they going to stop marriage of 9-year-old girl? How are they going to stop the violence and rape of girls in the name of marriage? How are they going to the difference in
فکر کنم ایشون سوالو گرفتن. خیلی ممنون، چون وقت تمومه، عذر میخوام. سوال ایشون اینه که
شما درست تنظیم بکنید
تقصیر من نیست من فقط مترجمم
Anyway, I like to know how a raping of 9-year old
I get your point. Yeah, I get your point.
میپرسن که چطوری تجاوز به دختر بچه‌های 9 ساله.
I think Nere can answer that better than me. But you're very right. And I'm not, by the way, if I gave you the impression that I'm saying that Islamic feminist is the solution, not at all. That is not what I'm trying to say at all, and I'm talking about.
I'm asking you, what is their, what, how are they defending that? How are they defending?
Yeah, I know.
Sexual rape of a 9-year-old as marriage and call it Quranic and
exactly.
holy.
No, it's very, very problematic, and so, thank you very much.